Road car.
Well, the part of the story that you neglected to say that I think is interesting to the audience is that you actually, the money was sewed around
Well, this happened when we were leaving, when we were ready to leave Beirut and go to Cairo, Egypt. So this is when we were taking the gold out of the country.
Okay.
So my mother made a belt, and she sold all the gold pieces in between each other, made a belt. So the golden belt.
So you left with the clothes on your back and the gold around your belt.
I had a friend that worked at the Harvard, one of the Harvard museums, and he was some sort of a poet. And one day I happened to tell several people the story, and he was there, and he wrote a 3-page poem called His Golden Belt.
Well, and quite appropriately so. Well, when you get to Beirut, Syria, now your father wants to, family wants to immigrate, and it was a question of going to France, and your dad was fluent in French.
Well, my father spoke French, Turkish, Armenian fluently, wrote, writing and reading and talking. And so that his first choice was to go to France. We knew nobody in France, but we had a lot of relatives in this country on my mother's side. My mother had 3 brothers and a sister in this country and several cousins. And one of the cousins was married to a fellow that was the editor of the Armenian newspaper in the Boston area. So anyways, they knew we wanted to come, so we applied for visas to go to either France or United States. Well, we had no one to help us to go to France, evidently, so. But the visas to go to the United States came through.
Well, so in some way, it was a kind of a luck of the draw.
Of course, this started from when we were in Egypt.
Right.
Yeah.
I missed a step here, Mr. Koumjian. You went from Syria,
Beirut, Syria,
to Cairo, Egypt.
Cairo, Egypt.
And this is where you applied to go to either the France or the United States. And luckily for all your students, it happened to be the United States. Well, then in the fall of 1922, your family lands at Ellis Island.
Right.
Is millions of other people immigrating
I think we landed in Ellis Island, was it, to 1923.
Okay, 1923, Ellis Island.
Yeah.
But there was a small complication where your sister, Alice, was quarantined because of some sort of unknown
She had
disease.
A high fever, and they didn't know what it was, so they were going to, they held us up. They wouldn't let us go ashore. We had some people to pick us up and drive us back to the Boston area, but we were held there for about 5 or 6 days.
But luckily, whatever the problem was, cleared.
Cleared.
She was released, your family was released to start your life here in the United States.
Right.
And that began in Chelsea.
That began, we came to Chelsea, we lived in Chelsea.
And your dad was working at Boston College at the time.
Right.
And then there was another move to Sharon.
Yes.
And where your youngest brother Ralph was born.
Yeah.
And then to Arlington, and finally to Watertown, where your dad owned a
variety store,
the North Beacon Spa.
North Beacon Spa on North Beacon Street, Watertown.
As a matter of fact, I do remember that spa.
You do?
Yes, I do. And you then, during this time, start your schooling here in Watertown in the 9th grade at the West Junior High School.
That's right.
And then you moved to Watertown High School, where you were graduating class of 1933, where you played tennis, you threw the shot put, and there are many people that we know, some of the Hall of Famers here in Watertown, of class of 1933. And graduating, you then apply to and get accepted to Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and Boston College. You picked Boston College because?
Because I received a half scholarship, and the only thing It cost me the first 2 years at Boston College was $200. I think the tuition was $400, and I had a half scholarship, for which I had to take some exam, and evidently they gave me a scholarship of $200. So it only cost my folks, who didn't have too much money, Stowe was cost $200 a year for my education at Boston College.
And there you were a physics major.
I majored in physics.
Because math and sciences were your strong suit.
That was my strong suit, Grace.
And you played tennis? Were you outstanding?
I played tennis.
And you had an outstanding tennis career at Boston College, because I've heard it from people other than yourself. And finally, you graduate and move on. Well, in 1939, you start your
teaching.
Career in education at the East Junior
High School. East Junior High School, teaching science.
And then in a monumental event in the Koumjian life, you meet Mary Howard of Dorchester. And it, I'll use your quote from the last time we when we did this interview, was that it was love at first sight. And Mrs. Koumjian is, you will be celebrating your 64th wedding anniversary. So it's been a long, happy relationship. But, and that was in July of 1941, you marry.
Right.
December 7th, 1941, the same year, you, Pearl Harbor, World War II, you then are faced with military service. Mm-hmm. Early in sometime in 1942, early, you become an aviation cadet for the United States Army Air Force.
Right.
Where you report to MIT to study meteorology.
That's right.
And you spent this whole time there and graduate September of 1943. You are commissioned a second lieutenant and you are a meteorologist.
Right.
Working with Air Force pilots.
Yeah.
And the connection I do have with that, I was a pilot in the Army.
Yeah.
And one of the most important people and that you want to know and know well and understand is the meteorologist.
Yeah.
Because that weather, anybody who's ever flown an airplane has a weather story.
Yeah.
Several weather stories.
Yeah.
So you were an important person wherever you were. And your first base is, first assignment is to West Palm Beach, Florida. A small Air Force base where you are the meteorologist.
Right.
You spend a certain amount of time there doing your MOS, your job, and then you get transferred to a training facility in northern Florida. It was the Bascom Army Air Force Base.
Yeah.
Now this is when your life takes a turn. For whatever reasons, and I'm going to guess, it was because of your science and technical background, you get chosen to change your military occupation job to go to radar school, which was still in development stages at the time in 1943.
Right.
This is where that you get sent to, where did you get sent? Oh, Orlando.
Orlando.
Orlando, yes.
Orlando, Florida.
And you spent months there learning to be a flight controller.
Yeah.
Of course, there's no question that you completed successfully, and you are a flight controller. Well, what to the audience, a flight controller is, in your case, with the 7th Air Force, is to control fighters. In the area, you direct the fighters to intercept. You are the eyes of the fighter pilots.
You're right.
Now, your first assignment this radar school is to go to Pearl Harbor.
Right.
Where you happen to have a interesting reunion with a fellow teacher and later principal at Watertown High School, one of my favorite people, Tom Blake.
Tom Blake.
Now, that must have been a happy reunion.
Pardon?
That must have been a happy reunion.
It was very happy, yeah.
But then your fortunes change again, Mr. Koumjian, and there was a major flood who saw your name and said, I want that man. Who is Major Flood?
Major Flood was a student at Boston College, and I didn't know him too well. I mean, I knew he was at one time at Boston College. I think he was probably a year behind me. And I think he took one class with me, one math class, trigonometry or something of that nature. And so anyway, when he saw my name, he checked out to see who I was. He found out I was the John Koumjian that he knew from Boston College. And his job at that time was the air defense of the outer islands, like Hawaii, the island of Hawaii, the island of Maui, where he was stationed, and the island of, what's that other one north of
Kauai, and the big island of Hawaii.
Yeah. And anyway, so I was transferred over there, and somebody picked me up at the Air Bus and brought me to the control center in Maui. And so I met him there, and we renewed our acquaintances. And I was there for about 2 or 3 months, and essentially we were guarding the Hawaiian Islands from any future attacks by doing control work. If we saw some unidentified airplanes on the radar, we scrambled planes to go out and take a look at it. Of course, there was, most of the time, it was just planes that coming from the from America to one of the Hawaiian Islands, and they had somehow or other didn't have any recognition, so they had to go out and be recognized.
But anyway, there was something in the wind here. There was going to be the invasion of Yap, Y-A-P. It was in the Admiralty Islands.
Yeah, this was the, well, anyways, they were, while I was there, the suddenly, I think they were, they needed 4 controllers to go out on this next mission that was going out from Hawaii. So I was transferred, he selected me, and I think there were 3 other controllers selected, and there were 4 of us were supposed to go to this island Yap. So we went to Hawaii, back to the Oahu, and went up to a staging center, which was about 10, 15